Welcome back, everybody, to the third and final lecture for Chapter 9 in our ECON 2 class. As promised, we're going to be going over the granddaddy of them all, the aggregate goods and services market. So remember, we're talking about macroeconomic markets in this chapter. In Chapter 1, we talked about the resource market, focusing on the most common resource, which is labor. We also focused on the loanable funds market. In Part 2 of Chapter 9, we talked about that foreign exchange market. And so now here in the final video, we're going to be talking about the aggregate goods and services market and how that relates to the business cycle. With that in mind, this is a market that includes all final goods and services, which means that it counts all items that enter into our calculation for gross domestic product, which hopefully you still remember from Chapter 7. Right. So whenever we went over the goods and services market in Chapter 3, we always focused on, say, one good or service, such as, like, say, maybe the market for pizza. Right, that's one good that we examine with that supply and demand graph in that in Chapter 3. But here in Chapter 9, when we're talking about the aggregate goods and services market, we're going to be talking about the demand and supply of all things. Right, so we're going to be talking about the demand for things like pizza and haircuts, or things that households like to buy, also things that businesses like to buy, like office buildings, or things that the government likes to buy, whether it be like highways or national defense spending, right? So this is going to be the demand for all things and the supply of all things. With that in mind, the price in the aggregate goods and services market is the price index, which we're going to abbreviate with PY, and then the quantity in the goods and services market is going to be real GDP, or Y, right? So again, we're looking at this goods and services market. We're going to be looking at the relationship between price index, or the price of all things, and the quantity of all things, which is real GDP. Now let's go ahead and focus on that aggregate demand curve. So the aggregate demand curve is the relationship between the price level and the quantity of domestically produced goods and services that all households, business firms, governments, and foreigners are willing to purchase. Or again, everything that goes into GDP, whether it goes into GDP through that consumption component that the households spend money on, whether it goes through GDP in that investment component that businesses and firms like to spend money on, whether it goes through GDP or into GDP through that G component or government expenditures, or whether it gets added to GDP through exports. Remember, exports are added to GDP, so anything that people from other countries buy from the United States or anything that the U.S. exports to these other countries would also be included as part of this aggregate demand curve, right? And it's downward sloping for the reasons that you might expect. As the price level goes down, the quantity demanded for all goods will increase. So at lower prices of all things, we tend to buy more of all things. We'll talk a little bit about or break down the three reasons why this is downward sloping here in a few minutes. But first of all, let's just go ahead and graph out that aggregate demand curve. So if you've been following all the graphs up till now here in Chapter 9, you're going to notice a pattern. And that pattern is that they all have downward sloping demand curves. And this graph is no exception. So again, when we're graphing out our aggregate demand curve, it's going to look something like this, where we have price index measured on the vertical axis. Again, it's just the price level of all things. And then we have Y measured on the horizontal axis. Again, that's real GDP. And that's that same Y, by the way, that's that C plus I plus G plus NX equation that you learned back in Chapter 7. Right? And then again, you're going to have this downward sloping demand curve. Only we're going to call this, instead of just D, we're going to call it AD for aggregate demand, or again, the demand of all things, right? So when the price index is, say, higher, say that we got a price index of, say, 200, indicating that prices are twice as high as compared to the base year, then again, our amount of goods that we're willing to purchase is going to be lower. If we have a price index of, say, 100, right, again, this might be the base year, where, again, $1 is worth $1. Then, again, the output that we are willing to purchase is going to be higher. Right. So there are several reasons why this aggregate demand curve is downward sloping. Let's go ahead and go through these particular reasons. So going back to our full screen mode here, Right. Again, three reasons why a decrease in price level will increase the quantity demanded of all goods. Or you can also think of this inversely in that there are three reasons why an increase in price level will decrease the quantity demanded of all goods. So again, three reasons why there's this inverse relationship between the price index and the amount of all goods that we are willing to buy. First of which is a lower price level will increase the purchasing power of money. So as you might imagine, if the price of all things go down, then whatever money you have in your purse, wallet, or pocket can go out there and buy more stuff. So you're going to be willing to buy more stuff, right? So again, the idea here is that if you were to wake up tomorrow and everything was half the price that it was today, like your rent was half price, gas was half price, food was half price, then the amount of money in your wallet or pocket can go out there and afford more stuff, so you're going to go out there and buy more stuff with it, right? So again, a lower price level will increase the purchasing power of your money, right? The amount of money in your bank account or wallet hasn't changed at all, right, when these prices get cut in half, but just because the prices are lower, you're still going to be able to afford more with that same amount of money. A second reason is that lower price levels will lead to a lower interest rate, which increases both consumption and investment. All right, so let's go ahead and graph this out and explore why this is true. In order to do that, I'm going to kind of exit our full screen mode. So in order to understand how this works, we need to go to a market where we're looking at what happens that could change a real interest rate, which means that we're going to need to go to our loanable funds market, which we studied earlier. So remember, it's got interest rate on the vertical axis and the quantity of money being saved and invested here on the horizontal axis. Right, remember, you have an upward sloping supply curve that represents the supply of savings. And you got a downward sloping demand curve. And that's a straight line that represents the demand for investment funds, or again, our demand to borrow money. And where those two intersect, you're going to get, again, the amount of money being saved being equal to the amount of money being invested, or an equilibrium quantity of savings and investment, and an equilibrium interest rate, which we're just going to call R1 star here. All right. Now, again, I want you to imagine a scenario where you wake up tomorrow and everything's half price, so the money sitting in your pocket or wallet can go out there and afford more stuff, right? With that in mind, you don't need to hold on to as much money as you needed to hold on to before. So your demand to hold money in your wallet is going to be lower. In other words, because that $100 in your wallet can buy twice as much stuff if prices were to be cut in half, right, then you need to put less money in your wallet. That means that you can put more money in the bank, right? So again, when prices go down, you need to carry around less money on your person, right, like in your pockets or whatever, right? If you need to carry around less money in your pockets, then that means that you need to put more money in your bank account, right? So that's going to increase the supply of savings. So we'll call this S savings 2. And where that intersects the old demand curve, that's going to create a new quantity of savings and investment. We'll call it SI 2 star, right? And a new interest rate, which we're going to call R2 star. So again, this is what's going to make those interest rates go down, right? So again, it's going to lead to a lower real interest rate because you don't need to carry around as much money. You're going to put it in the bank. That increase in the supply of savings is going to make that interest rate go down. Now, when interest rates are lower, that means that people are nearly as eager to put money in these banks anymore because they're not getting as big of a rate of return as they were before. So remember that there's only two things you can do with your money after you have paid your taxes, and that is save it or spend it. If you're not saving it because the interest rates are lower, then that means that you are going to spend it, so consumption is going to go up, right? At the same time, right, people are much more eager to borrow money for the purposes of investment when interest rates are down, so that these lower interest rates will also cause investment to go up, right, as businesses borrow money to maybe invest in new machines or expand their production process, right? So again, lower prices will lead to lower interest rates, and that's going to increase our consumption and increase investment. And then the third and final reason why a decrease in price level will increase the quantity demanded for all goods is because a lower price level will make domestically produced goods less expensive relative to foreign goods, right? So remember that that net exports equation is equal to our exports minus our imports. Well, as you can imagine, if there are going to be lower prices in our domestic country, making our goods less expensive relative to the foreign goods, then that means that the imports are going to go down and the exports are going to go up. The exports are going to go up because now people in other countries realize that they can buy those American goods for cheaper. And the imports are going to go down because now Americans realize that they can buy American goods for cheaper. So they'll buy more U.S.-produced goods and less foreign-produced goods. Right, so when our exports go up and our imports go down, then that means that net exports are going to go up. Right, so remember that y equation that we're measuring on that vertical axis, y equals c plus I plus g plus nx. Right, well, because interest rates are lower, we know that consumption and investment are going to go up, and we also know that net exports are going to go up. When you start to combine all those things, then that's going to make your real GDP or Y go up. Again, people will demand more of those particular items. Right? So again, that's why our aggregate demand curve is downward sloping. Make sure you know those three reasons as to why that's true. All right, so let's go ahead and move on here. So what makes the aggregate goods and services market different than all the other markets you've studied so far is that when it comes to an aggregate supply curve, or the relationship between a nation's price level and the quantity of goods supplied by its producers, right, there is not one but two aggregate supply curves here. There's what we call the short-run aggregate supply curve, and there's what we call the long-run aggregate supply curve. So let me make sure that I explain the difference first between the short-run and the long-run before we start talking about the difference between these two curves. So in economics, the short run is a time period in which something is fixed, right? So there's something that cannot change, right? Whereas the long run is a time period long enough for everything to change, right? So for example, if you are running a business and you have, say, a leasing agreement with the owner of the building from which you're running the business out of, right? So you have this, say, one-year contract that says during this contract, you have to pay this much for to lease your space, right? And then during the time in which that contract is enacted, that is what we call the short run. Now, when that one-year contract expires and you can renegotiate your leasing rates, right, then that now becomes the long run. Or if you have a contract with your employees, so if you're giving your employees, say, a salary per year, and you have a contract that says you're going to pay them this much for the year, then, again, as long as that contract is in place, then we call that time period the short run. Now, when that contract expires and you and your employees can get together and renegotiate a new salary, then that is what switches that from the short run to the long run. So in the short run, things are fixed, usually by contract, whereas in the long run, everything can change, including whatever contracts that you previously had, because those contracts have expired, and again, you're up for renegotiation now. Okay. So with that in mind, make sure you understand the difference between the short run and the long run so you can understand how these two curves work. So let's start off by talking about that short run aggregate supply curve. So the short run aggregate supply curve is just like all the other supply curves that you've studied so far, and that it is upward sloping because at a higher price level, firms will improve their profitability and therefore cause them to increase output. So just as an abbreviation, we'll call the short-run aggregate supply curve the SRAS curve, right? And again, it's upward sloping because at higher prices, firms are going to be able to sell their goods for more prices for those higher prices, and therefore increase profitability and lead to higher output, right? And the reason why they're going to become more profitable is because many of the producers' costs are still fixed here in the short run. So let's go ahead and graph out the short-run aggregate supply curve and go through an example as to why it looks the way that it does, right? So moving on here, again, I'm going to go ahead and get out of the full screen mode so we can use some different colors. If you are graphing out this curve, then you're going to have, again, price index on the vertical axis, and then our real GDP, or Y, on our horizontal axis. And now, again, you're going to have an upward-sloping supply curve. So far, nothing new. But again, we're going to call this the short-run aggregate supply curve. And once again, if you have a higher price index, call this PI 200. Again, that's indicating that our prices have doubled since the base year. Then you're going to have a higher amount of output in the short run, and we'll call that Y2. If you have a price index of, say, 100, indicating that this is the base year, when those prices are lower in the short run, again, you're going to have a lower real GDP, right? So the higher the price, then the more all companies are willing to produce and sell, because, again, they're going to become more profitable, right? And at least this is how it works in the short run. Now let's go through an example of calculating this out. So, again, a company's profits is going to be equal to its total revenues minus its costs. All right. So let's say that we're starting here off in the base year where the price index is 100, right? So again, $1 in this year is worth just $1, right? So when we take a look at this, right, let's say this is a company that sells 100 items at $1 a piece. So that's $1 times 100. And let's say this is a company that when you add up all of its costs, including the rent it pays its landlord and the amount of money that it pays its employees, its costs are still equal to $100. Right? So again, if we calculate this out, then we have $1 times 100 is 100 minus $100. This is a firm that is making zero economic profits. Right? Now, what happens if our price index doubles here? In other words, prices go up to PI 200, right? So again, we've got a doubling of prices. Well, it's very easy for a company to go through with their pricing gun and theoretically just raise the price of their goods from $1 to $2 to match that increase in the price index. So that's 2 times 100. So they're selling 100 items at $2 a piece now because prices have doubled. However, do they have to double the amount they pay their landlords and their employees? Well, not in the short run, because remember, those the amount that they pay those individuals are held down by contract, right? Your landlord can't just raise the price of your rent because inflation has happened, right? Not at least until your contract or your previous tenant agreement has expired. In the same way, your employees can be like, hey, we need more money because prices have doubled. And be like, well, we can talk about that when your contract expires. But for right now, you agree to work for this much. So this is how much we're paying you, right? So again, your costs will generally stay at 100, but the revenues that you, because again, those costs are held down by contract, but your revenues will go up to, say, 200, and so your profits will increase from $0 to $100. In other words, the higher the prices, the more you can increase your profits in the short run. That is why you are going to want to produce more here as that price index goes up, and that's why we have an upward sloping short-run aggregate supply curve. All right, so again, make sure you know why that curve is upward sloping. Now, with that in mind, let's go ahead and talk a little bit about this long-run aggregate supply curve. This is going to look different than your other curves thus far because it is completely vertical, right? Meaning that the price level or price index has no effect on how much we are going to choose to produce, right? So it's vertical because in the long run, everybody has had time to adjust to all these price changes. So a higher price will increase costs as much as it increases revenues to the point where profits won't change at all. So firms are not going to have an incentive to produce more, right? So firms have no incentive to change production at any price level. Again, higher prices will increase their revenues, but it'll also increase their costs by just as much. So there's not going to be any effect on their profits, right? Now, one thing about the long-run aggregate supply curve that I do want you to know is that wherever you see this curve, this is going to indicate the potential output of the economy, which if you remember from Chapter 8, we abbreviate as Y superscript F, which is just our output or real GDP at full employment. And wherever short-run aggregate supply intersects our long-run aggregate supply curve, that is where the actual price level is equal to the expected price level, or that is where we have correctly anticipated what the inflation rate is going to be. So let's go ahead and graph out our long-run aggregate supply curve and talk about why it looks the way that it does. So again, we are in this aggregate goods and services market. We're measuring price index relative to our real GDP, Y. And again, this is what your long-run aggregate supply curve is going to look like. It's going to be completely vertical. And what that means is if the price index is 100, or if the price index is 200, or if the price index is anything in between, it's not going to affect how much we are producing. We are producing the exact same amount. And again, this indicates where we can find our Y superscript F, or output at full employment. Now, again, if you want to kind of understand the reason why this is vertical and why firms do not have the incentive to produce more in the long run when prices go up, again, we're going to have to take a look at that equation of profits is equal to our revenues minus our costs. Right. So once again, we're going to start out in the same situation that we did before, where this is a company that is selling things for $1 each, and they sell 100 items, but their costs, when they add up how much they pay their landlord and how much they pay their employees, is also $100. Then again, this is a company that's going to be making zero economic profits. Now let's take a look at what happens in the long run with this company. So let's say that prices double. Again, our price index goes from 100 to 200, so prices are twice as high as they were before. This company can then go through and change the price of their items and sell each item for $2 a piece. However, in the long run, remember, everything is up for renegotiation, including how much you have to pay your landlords and your employees, right? So your landlord comes to you and says, all right, your leasing agreement has expired. As you know, prices have doubled. When I go to the store, I have to pay twice as much for everything. You're selling everything for twice as much, so I'm going to double your rent in order to have the same lifestyle that I had before. So they're going to jack up your rent and make that twice as much. Your employees are also going to come to you and say, all right, our previous contract has expired. It's time to renegotiate the terms of my employment. Again, when I go to the store, I got to pay twice as much for everything because prices have doubled. You need to keep up with that cost of living increase and pay me twice as much as well, right? So the costs are going to double just like the revenues doubled, right? So their costs are going to go from 100 to 200 as that landlord has requested more money and as your employees have requested more money. So it's still 200 minus 200, which is zero. Again, notice that the profits haven't changed. And that'd be the case if prices tripled or quadrupled, right? Again, your costs are going to increase as much as your revenues, so your profits aren't going to change at all. So you don't have incentive to produce any more or less. So it doesn't matter what the price index is, that's going to have no effect on your long-run aggregate supply curve, right? That supply curve is perfectly inelastic or not responsive to that change in the price index at all. So again, make sure you kind of understand why that long-run aggregate supply curve is shaped the way that it is. Again, in the long run, right, these costs can change. In the short run, they're usually held down by some form of contract and therefore could stay low while your revenues increase, which is why in the short run, a firm is going to be willing to produce more as that price index goes up. But in the long run, it's not going to affect their profits at all. All right, so let's move on and talk about this idea of a short-run equilibrium. A short-run equilibrium occurs at the intersection of the aggregate demand and short-run aggregate supply curve. And we usually denote a short-run equilibrium with a lowercase e, right? So whenever we have a short-run equilibrium, which is where the aggregate demand and short-run aggregate supply curve are intersecting, but the long-run aggregate supply curve is not there, it's somewhere else, right? Then we again denote that with a lowercase e. So let's go ahead and graph that out real quick and take a look at what that might look like. Here we're going to have to exit our full screen mode to use our different colors more easily here. All right, so again, we're going to draw a aggregate goods and services market. Hopefully you know by now that means that price index is going to be on the vertical axis and our real GDP or Y is going to be on the horizontal axis. So you're going to have a short run aggregate supply curve that is upward sloping. Again, we just talked about why. In the short run, higher prices will improve the profitability of the firm as their costs are held down by contract. So they're going to produce more as prices go up. Right? Remember that we have a downward sloping aggregate demand curve. Earlier in this video, we talked about three reasons why it's downward sloping, or why at lower prices people are going to want to buy more, and at higher prices people are going to want to buy less, right? And then where those two curves intersect, that's going to give you, again, a lowercase e, call that E1 here. And that's what's going to give you your actual output, Y, and your actual price index, PI, Right. Now, again, in this same graph, we have a long-run aggregate supply curve. And we can draw it, that long-run aggregate supply curve, so that it is exactly equal to the intersection of that short-run aggregate supply and aggregate demand curve, and that would give us a long-run equilibrium. But the economy isn't always in long-run equilibrium, right? Sometimes it can be in what is known as a short-run equilibrium. So let's go ahead and draw those first. I want you to imagine a situation where the long-run aggregate supply curve is somewhere to the left of our short-run equilibrium. In other words, just imagine briefly that your long-run aggregate supply curve is right here. The reason why I'm doing it as a dotted line is because it doesn't have to be there. It could be somewhere else. Let's say for the time being that this is where your long-run aggregate supply curve is. So again, this is what your potential output is going to be. So we're going to have our YF, we'll call it YF1 here. As you can see, our potential output is less than our actual output. When our potential output is less than our actual output, or when we are producing more than what our potential output is, right, then again, that is what we call an expansion. So if we have a situation where our long-run aggregate supply curve is to the left of our short-run equilibrium, or again, our actual output Y is to the right or greater than our potential output, which is indicated by that long-run aggregate supply curve, then that is what we call an expansion. Now, if you have a long-run aggregate supply curve that could theoretically be out here to the right of that short-run equilibrium, we call this long-run aggregate supply 2, right? This is if that was the case, then our potential output would be out here somewhere. Again, this is the most output that we can sustain as an economy for an extended amount of time, right? But as you can see, our actual output is less than our potential output. If our actual output is less than our potential output, then that is what we call an economic contraction. Or again, if it's two or more quarters or 6 months or longer, then we call it a recession. So again, that's when your actual output is less than that potential output, right? So that is what we call, again, a recession. And that happens when your long-run aggregate supply curve is to the right of that short-run equilibrium, right? So again, where the actual output is in relation to the potential output, or where that long-run aggregate supply curve is in relation to our short-run equilibrium, right, tells us again where we are with regards to these business cycles. Are we in expansion or are we in a recession? Now, again, it could be the case that you could have a long-run aggregate supply curve that is going to be exactly equal to our actual output or our Y. And if that is the case, right, then that is what we call a long-run equilibrium, which is what we're going to talk about next. Right, so again, that's what a short-run equilibrium looks like. Again, this graph really isn't different than your other graphs, except that you do have this long-run aggregate supply curve in there that tells us where our potential output is. Right, think of that as kind of a marker as to where our economy can produce at a rate that it can sustain for a long period of time, right? Whereas, again, the short-run equilibrium tells us where our economy actually is. So moving on to this idea of a long-run equilibrium, that occurs where aggregate demand, short-run aggregate supply, and long-run aggregate supply all intersect at a single point, right? So this is, again, where all three curves are intersecting at the same point. And we denote that point with a capital E. A capital E is our long-run equilibrium. Right? So this occurs, again, when we correctly anticipate the price level. Remember, where short-run aggregate supply and long-run aggregate supply intersect, that means that we've correctly anticipated what the inflation is going to be, right? It also occurs where the aggregate demand curve is, right? So there is no expansion or recession when we are in this long-run equilibrium. Our actual output is equal to our output at full employment. And our actual rate of unemployment is equal to our natural rate of unemployment. In other words, our cyclical rate of unemployment is going to be equal to zero. Again, that's what we mean when we say we're at full employment, is that we don't have any cyclical unemployment. You still have structural and frictional unemployment, as we talked about in Chapter 8, right, which when added together gives us our natural rate of unemployment. So again, our actual rate of unemployment is equal to our natural rate of unemployment when we are in long-run equilibrium. So you can probably imagine what that long-run equilibrium is going to look like, but let's go ahead and draw it out just to be sure. So you want to exit the full screen mode here and start drawing in some different colors. Then you have price index on the vertical axis, and then you're going to have Y here on the horizontal axis. And just to be clear, that's that same Y equals C plus I plus G plus an X equation that we studied in chapter 7. Right, and again, you're going to have a short run aggregate supply curve that is upward sloping. Again, make sure you know why it's upward sloping. Again, in the short run, as price index goes up, we improve our profitability as businesses, so we're willing to produce more. You have an aggregate demand curve that is downward sloping. Again, make sure you know why it's downward sloping. At lower price levels, we buy more, and at higher price levels, we buy less. And again, there are three reasons as to why that's true that we talked about earlier in this video. And then at the same point that these two curves are intersecting, you could also have your long run aggregate supply curve, which is vertical. Again, know why it's vertical. In the long run, everything can change, including the costs of production that were previously held down by contracts, right? So your costs will go up as much as your revenues in the long run, so your profits won't change at all, regardless of what happens to price. All right, and when all three intersect, that's going to be our capital E. Call that capital E1. And that's going to give us our long-run equilibrium price index. And again, we're short-run and aggregate, we're short-run aggregate supply and aggregate demand intersect. That gives us our actual output Y. Wherever you see long-run aggregate supply, that gives you your potential output, or Y superscript F. If they're all happening at the same point, then those two are equal. That means that there is no expansion, no recession. Again, it means that we have correctly anticipated the price index when we're here in long-run equilibrium, or we've correctly anticipated the inflation level. And again, our actual unemployment is equal to our natural rate of unemployment, or our cyclical unemployment is equal to zero. Right? So that's what the long-run equilibrium looks like in this aggregate goods and services market. So with that in mind, you now know what all of these markets look like. We're going to talk a little bit about how that aggregate goods and services market relates to the business cycle here in a few slides. But first of all, let's get into this idea called the circular flows diagram. Right, the circular flows diagram shows the flow of output and income between businesses and households that are coordinated by the four key markets that we have been talking about. So not only is this kind of the culmination of the four markets you've learned in this chapter, this is kind of the culmination of everything that you've learned so far in this class. This is kind of the point that we've been working towards when trying to understand, again, this whole idea of a macroeconomic system. So I told you the difference between micro and macro is that in macroeconomics, we try to understand the system versus how maybe an individual acts within that system, right? And so this is kind of what this system looks like. Right, so here is the basic circular flows diagram. You have businesses, you have households, you have a government in between. The businesses pay taxes to the government. The household pays taxes to the government. That's how the government gets money. Right now, half of the circular flows comes from the fact that through that resource or labor market, right, then what's going to happen is that those businesses are going to buy those resources from the households and therefore send money to those households through that resource or labor market. So when people who live in these households work at these businesses, they provide their labor in exchange for income or the wage. And so that wage or income that these businesses are paying these households, right, is flowing from the businesses to the households through this resource market, right? So again, that's kind of what this flow right here is. It's money flowing from households, or sorry, from businesses to households through that resource market. And then what happens is households then take all that money that they receive in income and they spend it on goods and services that are being produced by other kinds of businesses, right? So again, this money continues to flow from households through the goods and services market to these businesses, right? Not only do households buy things from businesses, but businesses also buy things from other businesses, right? And the government tends to buy things from other businesses. And it all happens through that goods and services market, right? So again, you're going to have this kind of continuous flow that is happening, right, from businesses to households and through the resource market, and then from households back to businesses through the goods and services market. And the faster this flow is going, then the better we say the economy is doing, and that's what we call an expansion. The slower that this flow is going, then the worse we say the economy is doing, and that tends to be what we call those contractions or recessions, right? But remember, those other key markets also come into play. For example, you have that foreign exchange market, right? So for example, whenever we buy things from other countries, then we send some of this money to other countries, right? Again, so some of that money goes to these other countries whenever we buy things from them, and we pay them in our US dollars. And again, that's what we call imports. But then when we export goods to other countries, right, again, we send those goods over, and then they send that money right back. So we kind of have this system here that is kind of operating out or orbiting around our main system, where we send money out through imports, and then we get that money back through exports. So some of those, some of that money is, again, leaving and coming back into the system through that foreign exchange market. And then you have the loanable funds market. As you can see, there's kind of a lot of stuff going on there. So households don't spend all of the money that they are getting through their wages or income on goods. They save some of it. So some of this money kind of leaves the circular flows and goes through the banks in the form of savings. But at the same time, remember, businesses and some households for that matter tend to borrow money from those banks. So again, whatever money you put in the banks is going to get borrowed by these businesses, or in some cases gets borrowed by the government, right? And again, becomes part of that flow, right? And then you're also going to have, again, money flowing through and from banks through those net capital inflows and outflows, right? So with that in mind, that's kind of how this system works in terms of flowing together and what we call the circular flows diagram. Now, I want you to just make sure you understand the main idea of the circular flows diagram. I'm not going to have this picture on an exam and ask you to kind of fill in each one of these, but again, know the main idea as to when money is coming in this system and when it's leaving the system and how it's flowing through the system. All right. So speaking of money coming in and going out, there are what we call leakages and injections. So a leakage is when money leaves the system, and an injection is when money comes into the system. All right, so here's a brief video clip here. Again, kind of a way to break up the monotony of these graphs through something that I hope is a little bit more entertaining. So this is from the movie National Lampoon's Vegas Vacation, where I want to take a look at an example of a leakage in this financial system. So Clark Griswold has lost a lot of money at the casino. He goes to his crazy cousin Eddie in order to hopefully get some help. And cousin Eddie is going to help Clark out. As you can see from this clip here, though, he has caused there to be a leakage in this circular flows diagram in terms of where he was storing this money. And there's going to be an injection in terms of when he gets it back to give to Clark. Let's take a look.
Eddie, I've gambled away more money than you'll ever understand.
Try me.
$22,600.
Clark.
I don't know what I want to tell Ellen. I mean, if I could just get that money back, I could turn it all around.
Clark, you've been so good to Catherine and me through all these years. And I hate to see it down like this. I've got some... money stashed away, and it'd be my honor to help you in your time of need.
You mean it?
It's just one little problem.
I forgot where I buried it. Is it safe to be digging like this?
Oh, yeah. Watch out for the scorpions. I got money buried all over this yard, Clark. I used to have quite a little system for finding it. But, oh, wait, here's something. $28.
Got one.
$6.
Oh, yeah, you banned coffee. You know you can sprinkle that stuff on anything? Ice cream, mashed potatoes, or just eat it right out of the can for a quick pick-me-up.
Oh, my God. There must be over $100 in here.
Oh, yeah, that's from when I sold one of my kidneys. We didn't really need the cash at the time, but I figure, hell, with all the advances they're making in modern medicine, I might as well hurry up and sell it while somebody still wanted to buy it. Smartest thing I ever did, Clark.
Eddie, why do you have all this money buried in the ground?
For a rainy day, Clark. We don't get too many of those out here in the desert.
Where's the nearest casino?
All right, so I'm looking at that clip. When you have money buried in the ground like that instead of spending it or putting it in a bank, right, and that's what we call a leakage from the system. Now, as they dig that money up and he gives it to Clark and Clark's about to inject it into a casino here, that's that injection into the system. So that money's coming back into that circular flow. Right, so remember, when you're spending money, it's going to go back into the businesses. When you're saving money, it's going to go into banks that businesses are then going to borrow. Right, so as long as you're putting your money in a bank or you're spending it, then you're keeping your money in the system. But if you do things like bury that money in the ground or burn it up or whatever, then that's going to be a leakage from that system. Right, and again, if you were able to dig that money back up and put it back into the economy, then that's an injection into the system. Right. And again, the government will try to prevent leakages in the system as much as they can, which is why you're not allowed to destroy currency, or it's against the law to do so. So here's a quick practice question to make sure we understand this idea of a long-run equilibrium. So it says, which of the following is necessarily true when an economy is in long-run equilibrium? Right. So when an economy is in long-run equilibrium, it doesn't necessarily mean that prices will be constant or that inflation will be zero. Right. Remember, we do correctly anticipate the inflation level when we are in long-run equilibrium, but we could have correctly anticipated that inflation at 2% or 4% or whatever that inflation might be. And it is also not true that the actual rate of unemployment will be less than full employment or potential output. It's not true that the actual rate of output will be less than full employment or potential output. Right. It is the case, right, that our actual output will be equal to our potential output when we are in long-run equilibrium. And that means that the actual rate of unemployment will be equal to the natural rate of unemployment, or choice C is the answer we're looking for there. Again, the output of the economy won't necessarily be greater than our full employment output. If that's the case, we call that an expansion, and that is not something that we can sustain, so that's not our long-run equilibrium. Right. So again, B is denoting a case when we are in a recession. D is denoting a case when we are in expansion. Remember, in long-run equilibrium, we are not in an expansion or a recession, but we're operating at the full employment level, which means our actual rate of unemployment will equal our natural rate of unemployment. So C would be the answer that you'd want to choose there. All right, so let's talk real briefly about how this is related to our idea of the business cycles. So remember that we have recessions, we have expansions, and then we have the situation where we're operating at that trend line. So we're not in a recession or we're not in expansion, right? When it comes to long-run equilibrium, that's kind of us being on that particular trend line. But let's go ahead and talk about two potential causes of a recession. So there's two things that can lead to a recession. One is a fall in aggregate demand, and the other is a fall in short-run aggregate supply. In order to graph those out, I've already drawn the economies in long-run equilibrium, right, just so that you didn't have to struggle through watching me try to draw these graphs with straight lines on video. So I just drew them in advance to save us that time and effort, at least save you the pain of watching me struggle through it. But let's go ahead and exit the full screen, and let's talk about two cases where a recession could happen. One is which aggregate demand would unexpectedly decrease or go down. So if aggregate demand decreases, then that is a shift to the left of that aggregate demand curve. Again, all decreases are shifts to the left. All increases are shifts to the right. So we're going to have aggregate demand 2 here, right? Whenever the aggregate demand curve shifts to the left, it's going to create a new equilibrium where it intersects with that short-run aggregate supply curve, right? Now, this is a short-run equilibrium, so we're going to call this lowercase e2. We know it's a short-run equilibrium because our long-run aggregate supply curve isn't there. Right. Again, it's there at their original long-run equilibrium. Now, again, our short-run equilibrium gives us our actual output level, Y2, and then our actual price index, which is PI2. And notice that our actual output is now less than our potential output, and that is what we call a recession. So, again, this is two causes of recession, one of which is aggregate demand going down. That's going to cause the price to go down and real GDP to go down. And again, our real GDP is now less than our potential output or output at full employment. And that is why we are in this recession right now. Another potential cause of recession, as we mentioned in the last slide, is a decrease in our short-run aggregate supply curve. Right, so you can have a decrease in short-run aggregate supply looking something like this. And where that new short-run aggregate supply curve intersects our old demand curve, this is going to, again, give us a new output level, our actual output level, Y2, and a new price index, PI2. Again, this is our new short-run equilibrium, lowercase e2. Right, so we can see here that, again, we have a recession because our actual output is less than our potential output, right? But this time we have a recession where we have higher prices as opposed to a recession that we have lower prices. So what are some things that could cause that aggregate demand curve to decrease or shift to the left? Right. Well, one thing that could do is that people just become more pessimistic about the future of the economy. That might cause aggregate demand to go down. It could be something along the lines of people see a decrease in their income or their real wealth will go down. Right. So that could cause an aggregate demand to shift to the left. So, for example, if you have a stock market plummet, right, people start becoming less confident about the economy. They feel like they have less money because their stocks aren't worth as much. So they're going to go out there and buy less. That's going to result in a reduction in aggregate demand. Right now, something could happen that could cause a short-run aggregate supply to decrease. That might be something like some kind of temporary change in weather, so like a crop freeze or some other kind of natural disaster could occur that reduces our ability to produce, and that's going to cause that short-run aggregate supply to shift to the left. Right. So those are just a couple of the things that could change or shift the aggregate demand curve or the short-run aggregate supply curve. Right. So with that in mind, right, when we're in a recession, how do you know what the cause of the recession was in terms of, was it a aggregate demand decrease or was it a short-run aggregate supply decrease? And the answer to that is what happens to the price index or that price level. If we go into a recession and we see a decrease in the change in prices, so you see prices going down, right, then that means that aggregate demand has shifted to the left, or it's aggregate demand that got reduced. Now, if you go into a recession and you see higher prices for things, then that is a short-run aggregate supply shock, or that short-run aggregate supply shifting to the left. Right. So again, you got to look at what happens to the price level to figure out what caused that particular recession. Either case, though, you've got output below your potential output or your output at full employment. So those are two causes of recession. As you can imagine, there are two potential causes of an expansion or boom. One is an unanticipated rise in aggregate demand, and the other is an unanticipated rise in short-run aggregate supply. So let's go ahead and graph those out. And again, to save us the time and you the pain of watching me struggle through drawing these graphs, I went ahead and drew them in advance. Right, but let's go ahead and talk about what happens when aggregate demand increases. Again, an increase in aggregate demand is a shift to the right of that aggregate demand curve. Again, all increases are shifts to the right. That rule hasn't changed. And when that new aggregate demand curve intersects short-run aggregate supply, this is our new short-run equilibrium. We'll call that E2. And that gives us a new actual output that is higher than our potential output. Remember, it's possible that our actual output is higher than our potential output for at least a short period of time. Remember, that potential output isn't the most we can possibly produce. It's just the most we can sustain. And when that actual output is higher than our potential output, right, then that is what we call an expansion. And in this case, it's an expansion that is going to have higher prices associated with it, right? So again, we're talking about two causes of an expansion. An expansion is what happens when our actual output is higher than our potential output, right? So again, you could have something like an increase in real wealth. So like a stock market boom might cause people to feel more confident in the economy or more optimistic about that economy and go out there and buy more stuff, which could lead to that expansion. Right. Now, you could also have an increase in short-run aggregate supply. So if you had, say, really good weather, right, that could be something that could increase that short-run aggregate supply curve or shift it to the right. So that short-run aggregate supply curve now shifting to the right is going to create a new short-run equilibrium where it intersects with that aggregate demand curve. Right. Where those two curves intersect, that gives us a new actual output, again, Y2. Notice once again that it is now greater than our potential output, right? That is what we call an expansion, when our actual output is greater than that potential output. Only in this case, because we're producing more and have a lot more out there, right, we're going to have lower prices. So again, in both cases, actual output is greater than our potential output, or an expansion or economic boom has been created. Now, how do you know what created that boom? Is it an increase in aggregate demand, or is it an increase in short-run aggregate supply? In order to answer that question, you have to look at what happens to the price index. If we are in an expansion that involves higher prices, then that's usually the result of an aggregate demand increase. If we are in an expansion that involves lower prices, then that is the result of a short-run aggregate supply increase. Right, so that is, again, two causes of the expansion or economic boom. Be able to tell the difference between them based on what happens to the price index. And that is it for the what I would say is the hardest and most graphically intense of all the chapters in the class. Right, so make sure you know the resource, loanable funds, and foreign exchange markets. Be able to tell me what each of those markets are measuring. Remember, in the resource market, we're measuring the relationship between wage and employment. In the loanable funds market, we're measuring the relationship between the real interest rate and the quantity of money being saved and invested. And then in the foreign exchange market, you are measuring the relationship between the price of foreign currency and the quantity of foreign currency. So know those axis labels. Know the reasons why these curves are sloped the way that they are. So know why the labor demand curve is downward sloping, or why the supply of loanable funds is upward sloping. Right? Be able to answer questions like that on the quiz or exam. And then know how to shift each one. It's pretty easy. All increases are shifts to the right. All decreases are shifts to the left. Know what happens to the price and quantity in each market, no matter what we call it, when those changes occur. Make sure you know the difference between the nominal and real interest rate and how inflation affects borrowers and lenders. Remember that the real interest rate is the nominal interest rate minus inflation. If inflation is higher than anticipated, then the real interest rate is going to be lower than we thought it was going to be, so that's going to help borrowers at the expense of lenders. If the inflation rate is lower than anticipated, then the real interest rate is going to be higher than we thought it was going to be, so that's going to help lenders at the expense of borrowers. Remember, inflation doesn't tend to help borrowers or lenders in any systematic manner, though, so it doesn't tend to help one more than the other. With that in mind, know the relationship of imports and exports and capital inflows and outflows in the foreign exchange market. Remember that when we are in the equilibrium in the foreign exchange market, then it is the case that exports minus imports is going to be equal to those capital outflows minus those capital inflows, right? Again, if one side is negative, then the other side must be negative. So if we're in a trade deficit, then it must be the case that capital inflows are greater than capital outflows. If we are in a trade surplus, it must be the case that capital outflows are greater than capital inflows. Know that aggregate goods and services market, right? Again, be able to label the axis. We're talking about taking a look at the price level or price index relative to that Y or real GDP. Know why all three curves are sloped the way that they are. So know why your short-run aggregate supply curve is upward sloping, your aggregate demand curve is downward sloping, and your long-run aggregate supply curve is vertical. Right, remember, the short-run equilibrium is where the short-run aggregate supply curve and aggregate demand curve intersect. Right, that gives you your actual output. The long-run aggregate supply curve is what gives you your output at full employment, or your potential output. If all three curves are intersecting at the same point, then that gives you what we call the long-run equilibrium, where your actual output is equal to your potential output and your actual rate of unemployment is equal to your natural rate of unemployment. And then know how the aggregate supply and aggregate demand model relates to these business cycles. In other words, know the two causes of a recession, an unanticipated reduction in aggregate demand or an unanticipated reduction in short-run aggregate supply. Know two causes of an economic expansion or boom. That is an unanticipated increase in short-run aggregate supply or an unanticipated increase in aggregate demand. Right. And again, be able to tell which one is causing this outcome based on what happens to the price index. So that is it for Chapter 9. If you are somebody who hates graphs, then feel confident that the rest of the chapters moving forward don't have nearly as many graphs as Chapter 9 does. We are through the most graphically intense part of the class, right? If you're somebody who loves graphs, I'm sure you had a good time with this chapter, right? But understand that there's not as many graphs in the future, but we will be kind of going back to these graphs every now and again in these future chapters. All right, but that's it for now. Please let me know if you have any questions. As always, feel free to shoot me that email or come visit me in those Zoom office hours, and I'll be happy to answer any questions that you may have about this chapter, these graphs, or anything else in the class. Right. Until then, just let me know if you need anything and take care.